She's like getting ready for it. All right, and we're on. Three, two, one.
We're on. What's up, Pack? Steve Del Savvy from the Ask the Pack Leader Show. I'm here with Jamie and Adam.
Hi. Should we have timed this?
I just figured it'd be funny to do, like, not, clearly not that funny to these guys, but maybe you guys found it funny that we always do the what, and I just said, what's up, because that's what it sounds like when sometimes when Cassie's trying to explain things to me, it sounds like the Micro Machine guy from the commercials back in the day. Do you know that one?
Micro Machine? No.
Oh my God. Do you know it?
I want to say I do. It's like a... like a box set where that has like toy, like it was little, it cars.
Was, yeah, little cars. Yeah, yeah. And there was the guy who was like the world record holder for speaking or reading the fastest.
Yes, I do remember that.
And he would go, Micro Machines. Yeah. And then the guy, the people were like. And there was, and speaking of which, they were actually, I think he was like the substitute teacher on one of the shows back in the day. And he came in and was like, okay, well, I'll be subbing for your teacher. My name is whoever. And I'm going to be reading all the information you will need for the upcoming test tomorrow. And he goes, Thomas Jefferson was born in... And, he goes, and people are going, that the smoke's coming up and shit. So good.
I don't remember that.
What's up, Pack? So how are you guys? We're here again. Another Ask the Pack Leader show. We'll do it the right way this time. Mm-hmm. We have Jamie here and we have Adam. Hey. Episode number 24 of the Ask the Pack Leader show. Is that right?
I think so.
You know why? The only reason I remember that? What? My number was 23, and last week was number 23.
Oh, look at that. Forget.
From that to this point forward, we're fucked.
You're dead. Then on 25, it's going to be like, you know why I remember 25? It's because
because it was
he has this other thing.
couple of housekeeping things. Well, just some stuff to talk about is beautiful weather here at the ranch. Now we had snow and bullshit forever.
It's feeling like spring.
Yeah, finally feeling like spring. We got 60s here, which is like people who are living in like Cali and Florida are like, okay, pal. But for us, like, it's beautiful. The weather is really nice. No humidity. Sun's out.
No more sad.
Nah, mornings are cool. Nights are cool as soon as the sun goes down. But during the day, the sun feels fucking amazing. It's so good. And the dog park and everything with the blue skies, it's like incredible. So camp's going, and we're rolling this out in a very calculated way. We started with Hoboken because that was what we did tons of walks in Hoboken. Believe it or not, that van is pretty much full at this point. So if you're in the Hoboken area, and by the way, if you live in the New York City area, we do have the ability to have somebody, you can come to we call it like the bus stop.
Come to Hoboken.
Yeah, if you're not living in Hoboken. So in Hoboken, we're doing door-to-door kind of thing, but we also have a stop in Hoboken for some of the people in Jersey City, Weehawken, some come from Manhattan, Brooklyn, wherever. Because they want to send their dog to camp. So we have that option too. We just rolled out another van in Ridgewood, New Jersey. So if you're in Ridgewood, New Jersey or in that area, we're doing that now. We just started that, a week ago? 2 weeks ago?
This is our third week.
Third week. And that's already, we started with barely any. And that's already up to 8-9 dogs now. So we can fit up to about 20, depending on the size of the dogs. Yes, we're working on. We're figuring that out. But it's happening way faster. I shouldn't say way faster than I expected, because I remember...
You would expect us to have six vans.
Do you remember the day in Hoboken? It was... I don't know when it was. It was probably 2 years ago when we got out the whiteboard and I broke down this camp down to the fucking scent of the collars.
Oh, yeah. You and
everything.
I spent hours breaking it down.
So it was like... And this is why I want to tell you guys, we always talk about this, but getting into business of how critical it is to understand business and things. Cause we broke it down to
gas prices,
gas, miles. This much is going to cost in gas for this many miles.
And if we have this many staff and the driver,
how many poop bags are
insurance,
we gonna
need?
Yeah, like everything,
all that.
Everything. So this is our all in cost. We thought of every possible cost that we could have, including there was an accident. There was all these other variables and stuff, and broke it down. And then I was looking at the margins and I was like, okay, so this could still work.
How are we not doing this?
This could work. And I'm like, so wait, and then this is what other people are charging for it, and is what they're offering. So we can offer so much more than these people. So that's that's what we're doing.
Was even before we had this place.
Yeah. And I'm trying, what we really want to do is revolutionize the whole dog care thing. Mm-hmm. Whole dog care industry, for real. That's what I'm planning on doing, and that's what the team here we're planning on doing, is to just revolutionize dog care. Switch it from... sending a dog. Oh, I got to get my dog to do something through a day. Mm-hmm. Let me spend 20, 30 bucks on getting my dog to walk 30 minutes in an unstructured way. Not that good.
Or sending it just to an indoor box.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying. Or let me spend 50, 60 bucks and send the dog for the day. Or wherever. It depends on where you live, obviously. But around that, send them to the warehouse, which is your standard stick them in this box thing. They sell you on the dogs. They're so having so much fun and so social and this and that. dogs a lot of times learn some anxiety things and they get overexcited. There's not much structure to it. Sometimes this is not all, but most of what I've seen from when I went around, places are somewhat dirty. They're not upkept very well. There's part-time people working who don't really understand dogs. You have the high schoolers, the college kids, that kind of stuff. Not really professionals who really understand dog psychology working with the dogs. And they're in a box. Like, I went to one place. I remember going there, and I was like, this is what it was around the Hoboken area. I won't name the place, but I was going around, and this was when Cassie and I were going around, like, in stealth mode. Yeah. Like, just trying to act like we had dog, we're considering the camp, or we're looking for a job, or that kind of thing. I couldn't do that one. Yeah, that's, so I didn't do the job thing, because they were like, what do you mean? You have your own business. But
stupid.
Yeah, with Cassie, they didn't really know of her as much. So she was, like, applying to a bunch of the places. And I said, I want you to go there and just take note of everything, ask some questions, ask these questions, and let's see what's going on. Mm-hmm. And she would come back and report, and like, she's like, first of all, we're golden, number one, but number two, these places are way worse than I expected. Mm-hmm. And it's a lot of stuff that goes on behind the scenes that people don't see, which is, you know, a lot of the bullshit, just dirty areas where the food were, flies and crap like that. You know, they leave, you know, I went to one place, and this is the place that I went to. I actually went with a realtor guy, friend of mine. Mm-hmm. And we go in there, and I was just seeing like what they do there, and I was gonna see like what how do they run things, and what does it look like inside? So we go in there, and I'm like with my hood on and my hat and everything, just like, oh, and where did the dogs stay? And, oh, right in here. And the guy's like selling me on how much they love it and stuff. I look in the room, no joke, was the size of this room here.
I believe that
there was multiple shits on the floor. There was urine on the floor. One person in the room with about 25 to 30 dogs. And the dog's just like literally pacing around, bumping into each other and like doing nothing really all day. Mm-hmm. So it was a little bit depressing for me as someone who understands their psychology and stuff to see them like that. But I said, you know, me getting frustrated, like these people obviously don't know. They're not intent. Maybe they do, but they're not intentionally trying to like do a bad thing for these dogs. I hope. Maybe they just don't know what they can actually do for dogs. So as I'm like saying this, I'm looking this way and I'm like looking. So just so you guys understand, through the windows behind here is the dog park back there. And I'm looking at some of the dogs back there with them and like the sun beating down, the beautiful turf, the fence. It's just, it's a dream come true such for us. Difference. And it's like, so makes what makes me so happy is seeing the dogs experience it. So just having it is one thing, but seeing them experiencing and almost like the vision, like actually happening and being like, oh, we were right about that. They are going to love it. It is beneficial. And I'm asking clients, how are the dogs? So how are you liking it? How are they after? Like, oh, they're wiped, but they're feeling good. I'm like, yeah. This is what we wanted.
That's the goal.
Yeah. So the camp's going. So if you're in that area, and we're actually considering another area too. And we're going to need help with drivers and we're going to need help with handlers. So that's another thing too. If you're interested in joining our team, we're always looking for help with that because we're growing pretty fast. What else? Video calls. So a lot of people apparently don't know, but I do video calls. So I do one-on-one video calls with people. And this really, I really never did it until coronavirus. So I was like, well, how can I connect with people since I can't go to their homes anymore? And coming here in the beginning was not an option, obviously, because we didn't know what the hell was going on. Right. Like we, you know, the way the media sold it was like, if someone comes here, like we're all going to die in 5 minutes.
But no in-person sessions.
Yeah. Yeah. So, so we didn't do that. And so I was doing video calls. And at first I was like under the impression, I was like, I'm not gonna be able to help these people because I can't feel the energy of the dog. I can't really like feel what they're like. I can't see their place. Like you need that feeling a lot of too. But then I realized, you know,
is why I think you never did it. In the beginning.
Like yeah, that's well, that was the reason why I didn't do it. So then when I was like, you know what, I'm going to try this. And I'm going to like see how I can do it. Let's see the best I can do. At least I can advise these people because there's things like a lot of these people. Listen, if it's coming down to like, I want to know my movement isn't the correct. It gets a little bit tricky. But if they're saying like, I'm really struggling with my dog, like busting through the front door kind of thing. We ask them to send videos prior to of how they're doing it so I can assess those and then explain to them this is what you should do, the steps of it and why. But what if he does this? Blah, blah, blah. So that's the difference between when people send me a message on Instagram. It's usually like, this is my question. Excuse me. But by the way, sometimes people are sending me way too long messages. So just so you guys know, when you send me the novel, I'll read it eventually, but that goes like flagged and I come back to that when I actually have time. Like when I have a good amount of time to sit there and read that.
So the shorter, the better.
Shorter the better. Like 2 to 3 sentences of just like description. This is my situation. This is what's happening. What can I do about it? Kind of thing like that is easier. And video is the best. If you can send me video, I can see, because you're giving me what your perception is as a human based on your knowledge of dog psychology, but the dog might be saying something else in their language, right? So that's important to see. So if you're interested in video call, packleaderdogs.com/contact.
Correct.
Yeah. packleaderdogs.com/contact. 1 hour video calls we're doing, and they've been great. I mean, I really enjoy them. I end up staying on sometimes longer than I should. Because I'm
most of the time.
Yeah, because when I like the people, I'm just like, I don't give a fuck if I have to go an extra 30 minutes here to make sure they understand it if I have the time available.
And what I love about them too is that you can help people from all over the world. Like we've had so many people from
Australia,
other countries.
Australia, England, Germany, Netherlands, Canada. I was going to do a joke there. we're up Mexico, Central America, Brazil. There's been so many though. I mean, I could probably keep going on and on. Italy, we had Italy.
I have an idea. Why don't we do a group like follow up, and you can see everybody on that screen there.
Mm.
All of them. It'll be like 10, 15 people, and they're from Mexico, all these different places.
Yeah. I like
Even if it's just to say hello, like, hey guys, you're on the podcast. Right. Like, I just want to see how you guys are doing.
Yeah, that would be kind of cool. Like people that I've spoken to from different countries, and it's like, oh, there's Mexico and Germany and Italy and Canada. And wherever the fuck, you know. The reason
right away my mind goes to how are we gonna coordinate the time differences.
I don't know.
Like I'm always. Doesn't matter.
They'll have to figure it out.
Yeah, exactly. They're gonna have to figure it out. Yeah, like
they revolve around us. Sorry, guys.
2 a.m. You're on it.
No, the reason I was laughing about the Canada thing, my dad is such a fucking. He's like, so we used to go on this back in the day. We used to go on the Disney cruise. He would take us on the Disney cruise. So there was
your favorite one.
Yeah, there was some comedian that would come on. Well, first of all, the Disney cruise is like it was mostly like the parents with the kids and. Not all. There was a bunch of couples who would go and things like that. But for me and my brother, like we were in our I was in my mid 20s. He was in my younger 20s and he was like 19 and shit.
Yeah, can I ask why it was Disney if you guys were
because
so
my
old
parents, man? My parents liked going to Disney and they were introducing this like cruise line thing. And Disney's known for their service. Mm-hmm. That's so funny that we're actually talking about that because that's what we're going to talk about today is the Disney kind of thing. But they were known for their
we actually didn't plan that.
Their service, we didn't. Their service, their cleaning, how well they take care of the customer service. By the way, you hear me say it here. I said, guys, I want to make sure our clients we're giving them Disney level service.
Yeah.
Because Disney, when you go there, I don't know if I'm sure a bunch of you've been there. You go there, it's like you go up to anybody,
I've never been.
And they're like, hey, could you tell me where I can get a?
You're lying.
I've never been.
To either, so
you
to none of them?
See that window, just metaphorically speaking, by the way.
I was thinking about going to Disney World.
Yeah.
This before summer, maybe.
Yeah.
I was thinking about it because I've never been to that one.
Just it's Disney just, in California. It's Disneyland like on steroids.
I bet.
So it's just bigger. It's just huge.
Disneyland in California has California Adventure and all that stuff. It's cool, but I want to experience like the real thing.
Yeah.
Like,
so we were on the cruise. Oh, so there's a comedian on the cruise and he was actually pretty funny. He's a kind of a prop comedian and he would, but he was like a magician slash comedian, but his magic like wasn't the greatest, but he would like do comedy with it. So he would start his show, ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls, people from Canada, like as like they're not people at all.
Separate from everything.
Yeah. And my dad brought that up and he was laughing.
What made you think of that?
Because my dad just brought it up recently. He goes, remember that comedian guy who used to say people from Canada? And he started laughing his ass off like it was the funniest joke he's ever heard in his life. I'm like, you love that guy. He's that guy's hilarious and everything. You know what? If I can remember
we should
name,
get him for your dad's birthday.
I know.
It's coming up.
Now you just fucking spilled the beans. But anyways,
it's okay. He doesn't watch this.
That's right. He doesn't watch it. It's like I don't watch my stupid son on that show.
The one show he is going to watch.
Yeah,
right.
Okay, so that was, we talked about the video calls. Next week, we're going to bring Cassie, my fiance,
who's
on
that?
The show.
Who's Cassandra?
She's this female who works for us who breaks my balls a little. No, she's Cassie's gonna come on. She's my fiance. She works in the business. She's been basically like CEO for the last X amount of years with me, kind of. And we're gonna bring her on and talk some shit and see.
She's gonna replace me next week.
Yeah, we're gonna see, because that's what we want to do. Is we want to bring on, like we've been talking about, bringing on different staff members so you guys can like meet the team and see how I interact with them. We'll have them answer some questions and things like that. That'll be really cool. So you guys can see that it's not just me here. It's a team behind that we're educating and making sure we're all like growing and really understand this dog stuff. Okay, and then the last thing I have on my housekeeping stuff is...
Oh, show and tell.
Yeah. Do you have her Instagram that you can pull up, the picture?
Yeah, I can pull it up.
Put that up, and I'll show you who like her. So this is a girl who just... there's actually a YouTube link, too. Maybe I can find it for next week. But this is her page. This is Ellie, and I'm not sure where she lives, to be honest. Whatever. But she said, hey, she sent me messages and asking some dog thing. She follows the page, avid follower. And she was like, she asked me, because she goes, can I draw Nico? And I said, yeah, of course you can draw Nico. She's like, that's amazing. And I'll draw it. So she drew it and finished it. You can actually see it there, but I'll show you here. This is what she drew, pencil drawing of Nico when he was a puppy. Can you see it?
Yes.
Yeah.
Really good.
It's so good.
It's really nice. But the best part
about
this...
Don't you love
this,
getting random stuff like that,
okay,
in the mail?
Let's put this in the caption if we can. I'm going to send you the link to the video she did about this.
Oh, yeah.
So it's a video of her draw... I think it's like I remember seeing it. She's like kind of like drawing like the step-by-step of how she drew him. But throughout, she's describing what I say about dog psychology.
Oh, shit.
Super dope.
Oh, yes, remember that. I do. Yeah.
Super good.
This.
And she's like... And that's as amazing. Steve at Pack Leader Dogs always says, exercise before... like, and I'm like, this is so fucking good.
I love
that. We have to share that. We should just share that on our page, period.
Yeah.
Like, just share it.
We should, and maybe we can commission her for certain things, too.
Nico. I can't believe that he's, like, used to look like this.
He's almost a year.
That's crazy. Yeah, Nico's going to be turning...
Two weeks.
Yeah, he's going to be turning 1 year old on April 5. Right, Kat?
I thought it was 4.
Birthday?
No, it's 4. 4, 20. It's April 4.
April 4.
Sorry, Nico.
So we forgot your birthday.
Yes.
I thought it was 4. The 5th, but okay. Maybe I'm thinking the flight when we went there. I'm making excuses.
Just it's the 4th.
Okay. So whatever. So that's that. But good stuff. Yeah. So camp stuff, the video calls, Cassie on the show next week. We got this done. Really good. So feel free to draw anything you guys want. I love art. We were just talking mm-hmm. about this before. Like this kind of stuff I think is like fascinating. It's so good. It's just, you know, someone could print this out and it's just different than looking at knowing that someone was there and spent the time. It like has a different feeling to it.
Oh, of course. Completely it's so feeling. Detailed.
Yeah, it's so good. The eyes and everything. And that's the thing that I notice about these kind of pictures and the other one we did with the Maddie photo is that when you look into the eyes, it's like almost like lifelike.
Mm-hmm.
It feels like it.
That's the biggest thing that they focus on.
Yeah. Yeah.
It's actually eyes. The eyes to get that life. Because if you have dead eyes, it's just going to be like, oh, this.
Yeah.
Everything's really good. It's really detailed, but the eyes just does something off.
Yeah, and that's
it
like for
make
me.
It pop.
Yeah, and that's for me. Like when I always talk about that, the dogs tell me a lot through the eyes.
Correct. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So I can like learn a lot by like looking at them. I can give you one scenario. I'll give you one. Then we'll move into the thing we're going to talk about today. But today, so I had
maybe
a session.
We'll
give you guys an example
halfway,
of a session.
17.
Right. So we're working. I'm working with the trainers here, and we're getting them. Listen. Compared to some of the trainers that I hear my clients are using, anybody here who works with us could do better sessions than what I'm hearing.
Mm-hmm.
So not all, again, but from the people that I'm hearing and how they're approaching these dogs, anybody here could do a better session. That being said, I want to make sure they're prepared to deal with all types of situations and stuff because, you know, like teaching this dog certain things, that dog certain things, this dog certain things. Sounds like a freaking race car just like started off. teaching them all those things. That's good, but be prepared for what happens when the dogs start showing teeth. What happens if this happens? What happens if they be prepared for all of it? So the scenario, someone came to the ranch. This is like I'm not trying to say anything bad, but this is what happened. So I walk into the consultation room here at the ranch and the dog's like staring at me and I'm like, all right, so this guy's definitely tense as fuck for sure. And I go and I'm like coming in and I come and I sit down and as I sit down I like sit like this and as I like lean back to sit the dog like is already with his paws on my like legs right here face here in my face and I'm sitting here like this and he's like pupils dilated like black, like big dilated things and he and I'm just like so I didn't say anything right so I so in that moment, there's no, hey, hold on one second. Let me just stay still. Let me calm down. Let me relax. Let me whatever. You're in it in that moment.
Yeah.
So in that moment, I was sitting there and I'm like this. And she's like, is this okay? And I go, no. And she goes, should I move him? I go, yep. And then she pulled him off. And I like was like, all right, just hold him there. And she goes, okay. And I go, just so you know, that was moments away from that dog biting me in the face.
That could have been really bad.
It could have been bad. And then it comes down to like bite inhibition and how many times has the dog bit and all that kind of thing. It could have just been, bah! And it's like, could have poked my eye or something like that. So what was my protection and my armor in that moment? Calmness. My calmness in that moment. Calmness and the ability to breathe, and with a dog growling in my fucking face, and be able to just relax. And I said, I was like, that's the closest I've been bit in a long time. And she's like, I'm so sorry. I'm like, no. I'm not saying it because of that. I just have to let you be aware of what was happening there. So if you let that dog.
And the potential.
Right. So and the dog's in there. His tail is up. He's like, ooh, growling at me. You would be like, wow, this guy is dominant, cocky dog, all this kind of thing, right? The moment that we put a leash on that dog and removed it from the owner, the tail was wrapped the entire time.
Mm. I wish I knew that you were talking about this because I have a video of it, but I'm just going to pull it up real quick.
And, you know, it's a situation. It's another one where the girl got this dog a year ago. And she went to the trainers and she got the dog. When I said, what was he like when he first came? I said, can I take a guess? And she goes, yeah. I go, super insecure, fearful, unsure, didn't know what to do, but you weren't seeing any signs of aggression yet. She's like, that's exactly what happened. I said, then what happened? You started getting training? Yeah. And then she started with the treats and the bullshit and all. And then, okay. And then this happens. This is where I start getting into it. And I'm hearing a lot from the same place. And if you guys keep doing this shit, you'll know who you are. And I'm going to expose it sooner than later. So they go, and I don't like doing that shit, but when I hear this shit over and over
it's
again,
it's dangerous to continue that
behavior. It's messed up, and it's unethical, and it's wrong. Right. They sell her on a boarding train, right? And she says, great, I'm going to send my dog for, I think it's like it was like 6 weeks or something like that.
Okay.
It's like a 6 week boarding train. They send the dog, she drops it off, pays in full, and she goes to see what's going on. First day, hey, you need to come pick your dog up. Why? What's going on? He has terrible separation anxiety. Yeah, no shit. You're the trainer. You're supposed to be figuring that out.
Right. And aren't you supposed to be working?
We're concerned about him because he's not eating and he's not drinking water. Right. So I said to her, I said, just so you know, that's like code in our industry for like an excuse that you're concerned about him. Like he's not in a drink. So we don't want to like be liable and all that shit. You have contracts. You have all that. So explain to them, he's not having water today. So we're going to make sure he is. If not, like we got to see. So what I did to tell him, pick up the dog. Great. Obviously, you're going to refund me, right? No, we're not refunding you. That was your slot.
Didn't refund her?
No. No refund. And she had to argue with them back and forth to try to have the trainer actually like get some sessions instead as like a...
Compensation
for it. And she said she learned basically nothing during the session. There you go.
How does the place do that? Not give the money back if they weren't able to train the dog or take the dog?
They do it all the time.
They just go like this.
I know how.
Yeah, that's how. And they don't give a shit. And they're all about money. And they don't know how to deal.
Terrible.
And the truth is, they don't know how to deal with dogs like that.
Clearly.
So, whatever. These places are around.
So this is a dog growling in his face before. And look at it now.
Look at that. Yep. This is after I've worked this dude for a while. And when I first put the Slippy on, he gave me the typical feral dog, like, whole deal.
Yeah.
Like, squealing and screeching and spinning. He shat himself. Oh. He this and that. Look at that. Look at how confused the dog is. He's looking to the right. And like, what the fuck is this guy doing? I mean, you guys... Yeah. I think Adam zoomed in my ass here, I guess.
Adam, are you in a tree?
Don't worry about that.
No, he's up on a rock.
Don't worry where I am.
Yeah. We actually talked about making a big platform in there for like a video, for some video stuff. So I'm doing some.
Are you in a tree?
Look, right there, I just go, do not try that at home.
Yeah.
To the people. Because this dog will try that at home. If you don't know, if you're not prepared for this.
Yeah.
So what's preventing this dog from attacking me right here in reality is my calmness, but really the confidence there as well. Because they can't bite something he's not just going to go outright bite something that is stronger than him. So my confidence there is what he's like. Damn, this guy's stronger than me. And once I look, if I bring the owner back in, he can bite any minute, second, I should say. Yeah. But without the owner there, like he's like on his own now, and that's why the tail is low. This is actually after a while, so you can see the tail's not totally wrapped.
Yeah,
it was more just hanging down
before it was.
I mean, I did this for how long? An hour and 15 minutes. All this shit.
That part it might have been like 45 to an hour.
Yeah. So people say, "Hi, Steve, how do you get it with them?" Like, oh, well, they think, like, what's the quick, like, what did you do? What was the little thing you did there? It's like this boring ass shit for like 1 hour straight with this dog. And then, yeah, that was actually really good.
Mm-hmm. He comes to you.
So he's giving you way more eye contact now, which is good.
Yeah, so he's giving me way more eye contact right now, more curious about me, and I'm telling him, hey, bro, you're doing really good. So I'm doing for him what I'm trying to get people to do for themselves, mm-hmm. which is you be the thing. I'm going to treat you like the thing you are, like I know you can become.
Right.
So as a human, start acting like you are the thing you want to become. You want to be financially free? Start acting as if. You want to be confident? Start acting as if. And then all of a sudden, like, you have to have these men. I'm confident on this. I'm doing that for him right now. I'm saying, you're good, bro. You're playful. You're this thing. I know you're, like, in a really fucked up mental state right now, but I'm here to help you. I don't feel... look at that shit. Him coming there, that's fucking, like... Yes. And I didn't feel he was ready to be touched in that exact moment.
It's funny, right? Like, you see the guy who's there is like, move a centimeter, I'll bite your head off. Now it's like, just move towards me. You're all right.
Yeah. So what I said there was this is the guy who moments ago, well, not moments, but a little bit ago, was like, you can't move 1 centimeter or I'm going to bite you. To now, like, and I'm in your face before you can even sit down. To now it's an enormous deal if he's even willing to come near me. So it shows how out of balance they can become with certain relationships around people and because of people. But the girl was advised wrong, and I felt for her. I was like talking to her about it, and she's stressed. She spent so much money on this already. She's, you know, the time. She's got a job.
Oh, yeah.
Which is a lot of our clients.
Yep.
A lot of shit going on, and I felt for her, and I said,
he's like, oh,
you know, obviously for this, like, rehoming, they're not the most compatible, so rehoming is potentially an option. But mm-hmm. I told her, I said, one thing that we have to do for you, for him, for everything, is let's give this, like, a real try. Mm-hmm. Let's go for it, and let's see what we can get out of it, and let's go from there. Let's not make any decisions, because they can change. They may change by the day. So,
are you okay to talk about the waves that you go through, whether it's... I don't know if this is going to work.
What?
Right
away. Oh, yeah.
That Steve goes through. He went through waves of, like, I don't know how to get this message across to this client. This might not work. It might be board and train.
Yeah.
It's not just, like, you know right away.
No, because, the session. Like, this is what based on what I've seen so far and I'm feeling and what you're saying, is that this is what I'm seeing. But if the dog comes and it could be different. When I remove him from the client, it could be different. It could be, like, all of a sudden there's some issue that they didn't describe for us. Like, one of the dogs we had here, they didn't even mention about the dog's food stuff.
Right, you know? The food aggression.
Yeah, and that was, like, a whole spiel that we had to, like, deal with. Mm-hmm. So there's all things like that we have to figure out and go. So we don't know. I don't know how the dog's going to respond. I don't know how long it's going to take. I have a really, like, my guess is becoming more and more and more calculated and more precise based on the experience and the time doing it. But I'm also not always, like, certain of what it's going to be. I'm like, this is one that I could see potentially going either way.
Right.
You know?
But then you have some clients who really step it up and are committed. And sometimes clients probably
That's a huge factor. It's an enormous factor.
Like, right now they may not be compatible, but the client really steps it up.
Well, I say to them,
well, and it's,
yeah, but there's, they can be committed as much as they fucking want. But if time does not present the possibility of being committed. So if they're committed in the time that they have, that's cool. But what if this dog needs, you know, 5 hours of work per day? Right. And they only have 2 hours to work a day.
Right. And that's why you were going through those thoughts.
So they're committed, yes, but they don't have the time in their schedule. So someone could argue and say, well, they're not really being committed because then they would switch their schedule and change the job. And some people will do that.
Right.
Some people can't. So, you know, everyone's in different positions too. People just rush to judgment. And this is, again, what I came to. I've been talking about this with, like, everybody, like, how life really comes down to a couple of things, which is, like, one is it's good versus evil out there. That stems into all other things. Like, evil can stem into racism, sexism, hatred, anger, like, all this bullshit, right?
Mm-hmm.
Good can stem into helping and giving and all, you know, whatever. But the other one is that people don't want to really do the work anymore with anything. So,
yeah, not just with their dogs.
No, not with anything. With coming up with an understanding of, I wonder what's going on with the economy. I wonder what's going on with dogs. I wonder what's going on with nutrition. They just look and they try to take someone else's word for it and go with it. My God, I heard such a goddamn good quote yesterday. Sorry for the language on that one. People don't like the goddamn thing. So apologies. But I apologize to absolutely nobody. No,
Yourself?
Yeah. There was one something about, like, it was something about, like, the fuck, I can't remember what it is. I'm gonna find it. It was something basically about, but it described with, like, what I say, which is, like, it was basically like, are you the type of person that is just taking the truth of another that you read, mm-hmm. or are you finding your own truth to it that you believe at the core? You know what I mean? So it's like,
right, you're just taking somebody else's.
Am I just listening to somebody else says about dogs and just taking it as gospel and just saying, this is how it is and that's all I'm going to do? Or am I like listening to all and listening to things and then applying them, seeing how they work and say, well, I don't, you know, in my experience, the way I'm doing this, I don't see this to be working, but as this person's saying, and I found doing it this way works way better. You know, like that's to me like the real shit, but that's that.
You know, when you were doing the show and tell with Nico, I thought he was going to show the drawing of some Disney character that you had signed.
I did. Yeah, I was going.
Oh, yeah, you do have that.
I know.
We never showed that.
We did not. I don't think.
I thought we did.
I don't think.
We could show it on the next one. Yeah. We'll figure that out.
But it would have been perfect for this.
That
one.
Was. That actually got.
I think it might be downstairs.
So that actually got drawn on the cruise that I was on.
Right. That's so, what I was thinking about it.
Yeah, that's funny anyway. How this all like comes together.
Yeah, seriously.
All right, so today we're going to be talking about. Should I even just start describing it?
Yeah, let's go.
Yeah, so this is something that like I don't know why this didn't like slap me across the face like a long time ago, but it was like a revelation that I had like out of nowhere. It was, I think it was in a consultation. I was like, wow, and I just like looked at Adam and I was like, we need to talk about this. Yeah. Like it just popped in my head. So look, what you hear me talking about imprint period for dogs, how important it is, right? Imprint period for humans, just as important. If not more, because we live past, present, future. So, and that's a 0 to 7 year thing, right? 0 to 7 years about is your imprint period as a child. And I'm like, well, so why is it? This is not just, by the way, a one answer thing. So it's many different factors to it. But this is one that I think is a big chunk of it because it's culturally, especially for the United States, but other nations too. This is like Disney goes across many nations, right? Are you good?
Yeah.
Okay. I thought you looked at like I saw you looking like what the fuck's that?
No, I was just looking. Okay. I just check on things.
I'm just trying to be aware.
No, that's good.
Yeah.
Appreciate it.
Remind me to talk about at some point awareness when working with a dog. That I just thought of because that just reminded me too of like I'm doing this right now, but I'm aware of this thing happening.
You reminded me of that over the weekend.
Yeah, like awareness. Like I'm working with a dog, you got to be aware of the other things happening, the dogs, the environment, all that stuff. So 0 to 7 years. Okay. And I'm like, why is it that humans have this thing of treating an animal like a human, right? Why are we all treating, like, especially a dog, but like, it's all. Like, you go to the zoo and look, it's like, oh my God, look at the cute little, la, 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 la. And then meanwhile, it's like a tiger who's ready to, like you go in,
it
would kill you and it would snap your neck in a second. You know what I mean? Not that they will, but they have the capability to do that. And it's an animal that has a psychology and it's not a Disney character that was made up in a cartoon, right? So I was saying, well, think about this. When I know for myself and most growing up from 0 to 7 in kids, what are you watching? Disney movies.
Yeah.
Cartoons, right? All this kind of shit. And it's all, not all, but most of them are animals talking as it's speaking English or speaking whatever language you're in the country it's in and acting as humans over and over and over again. So look, from that age and imprint period, we're being told that animals are just like humans. They speak like humans. They think like humans. They behave like humans. So treat them as such. All right. So someone's going to be going and say, look at this movie with this type of animal, like Mickey Mouse. Oh, it's a mouse. It's Mickey. And then they reach to a mouse and mouse just like bites or something. Right. I don't know. Like, but that's not, a mouse is not thinking about the thing Mickey Mouse is thinking about.
No, not at all.
You know what I mean? That's a rodent. Right. That's like going around and like trying to eat food and figure out a way somewhere to sleep and how to mate and how to eat. You know, like that's what that thing's doing.
I thought he was going to bring up the New York rats.
I know. That's the
That's not Ratatouille.
You don't want to mess with those.
Yeah, those are bigger than Mickey Mouse, the ones in New York, the rats there. But, you know, or they see like 101 Dalmatians, they say. I'm like, oh, look, it's all that. They just behave like them. Let's get a Dalmatian. And the Dalmatian's like, wow, I'm not a Disney character. I have this dog psychology thing and you're weak. And like that.
Can I show some of these?
Yeah, start showing. Let's see what you guys came up with. Let's see.
So I told them, you said Mickey Mouse. So we got.
I said,
Mickey
let's bring, let's pull up some things so you guys see. So here's a mouse that speaks like a human. Looney Tunes, all like
this. I mean, could be considered an animal, but whatever.
The rest of them are all look, duck, rabbit, cat, pig. I don't even know what that's supposed to be. That
Which
guy.
One? Tasmanian devil.
Tasmanian devil. Yeah, bird. Dog over there, Goofy, all behaving as humans. You know what I mean? What else do we have?
And then so I went backwards a little bit because you did talk about Mickey. And then you said 101 Dalmatians. Go back up to that slide.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. So Lion King. I mean, Lion King is the definition of it.
That one's such a classic. Yeah.
That's all animals, all talking English.
Like, and by the way, we love these movies. We love these movies, but you're bringing up a really good point.
I love these movies. Yeah. I mean, Lion King is one of my favorite movies of all time. Definitely. For sure.
You guys, what am I thinking? You guys don't know how many times Steve has played in the newer Lion King. the beginning scene.
What's your count up to?
Oh, the Circle of Life. I lost track.
The Circle of Life.
He's played it six, so many times.
It just feels correct to play in here. So first of all, these are the reasons. This is just so everyone can understand. Is number one, it's amazing. And it's like the whole animal thing, the Circle of Life, all that is amazing, right? But it was when I had first got the new TV, the 4K OLED, and it's like that movie, and that is insane.
Yeah.
And we had just put in the Sonos, like the surround in this big ass place. And Rome cranked that. So anyone would come in and be like, yo, have you seen, like, it was literally for months. I'd be like, yo, have you seen the beginning of Lion King, the new one? They're like, no. And I'm like, oh, come over here. And then they're blasting through the windows and shit.
That's like how you were with Adam Sandler's movie. Yeah. That was great.
It's just so good. Like, it's such a good movie anyway, but at the same time, there you go. Orangutan. Is it orangutan? No.
A baboon.
Baboon. Yeah. I don't even know what he's supposed to be. What's it? What's Timon? Is that Timon?
Yeah, Timon is
what is he?
Chipmunk or some shit.
No. She knows muskrat or something like that.
Fucking something like that.
It's on the tip of my tongue.
Is it wild boar? I knew that you were a wild boar, a lion, all behaving as humans, all hanging out, talking, mingling, like dating, all this bullshit that goes on. But
101 Dalmatians, you got a cat-like lady. No, I'm just
crazy kidding. crazy lady who's got all these dogs and treats them like fucking all their kids, and basically, oh, these kids, you know. Charlotte's Web, the pig, the spider.
Oh, I used to love Charlotte's Web.
That was a great. Great, great movie back in the day.
Let's see what else you have here.
Okay.
Yeah, I mean.
Beethoven.
This wasn't as much. I mean, this was just the crazier dog, but still, the dog's crazy because they have no idea what they're doing with the dog.
Meerkat.
This is a movie they had no clue what to do with. This is like your average dog owner thing. Yeah. There's this dog, and the people are all crazy, and they're like, oh my God, and the father's going nuts with the dog, and the kids let him do whatever he wants, and all this bullshit. But they treat it like the dog goes and visits the girlfriend and all this bullshit. There you go. Lady and the Tramp is like fucking, that actually may be the definition for the dog owner. You have two dogs having a spaghetti dinner together, a Cocker Spaniel and a Schnauzer, it looks like, kind of dog.
At a dinner table
having an Italian dinner about to kiss on their date. I mean, is that fucking not humanizing a dog? If they call it anthropomorphism or whatever it is. Anthropomorphism. Like I'm not the best with the words, but. It's just basically humanizing another animal, so treating it as. I mean, this is like whatever. He's a beast, whatever he's supposed to be. Like Bigfoot or
that
some shit.
That one's freaking creepy, actually. Yeah. Think about it. That one's.
Yeah, but this one also that's basically objects.
That basically
also.
Is the.
Yes,
objects
as well.
That's true.
Yes.
The candles and.
Bestiality is the word that you're looking for on that one.
Bestiality?
Yeah.
What the hell is that?
Jamie, tell them.
Oh, like hooking up with animals and shit?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
Well, I don't think that's where they were going with it.
We're talking about
No, but listen, it literally says in the title, it says beast.
No, but it's that's definitely not it, people, by the way. But that actually is another metaphor for me and Cassie's relationship.
I wasn't going to say it.
She's a beast?
Yes. No.
And you're the woman. Yeah, I see.
Exactly. I'm a woman, and
Steve actually has that dress.
Yeah, exactly.
Perfect.
I wear that dress as soon as I get off the podcast.
Why did I just imagine you?
I'm going to do the next podcast in that yellow dress, actually. Now
you have to be Belle for Halloween.
Yeah, exactly.
Damn it.
What else do we have here? But that's like, I mean, look at this shit. It's all humans, right? Finding Nemo fish that talks. I have no idea what the fuck that is.
Yeah, I don't know Balto.
Yeah, it's whatever it is, but I'm sure that those things are talking. Oliver and Company, I don't even know what that is, but that's animals talking for sure. Yeah. I mean, I just thought of two, like, which we didn't even put here, the movie Pets. That Disney movie.
Oh,
Pets.
Oh yeah.
That's like.
I actually want to watch that one.
That's like they
I
have like
two.
The.
Yeah,
who makes those? It's Disney, but Pixar. The Pixar ones.
Yeah.
Like that.
I think Kevin Hart's in that one.
Yeah. So good.
Finding Nemo is so good.
That's
another one I didn't even think of. The Pets one that I saw that because someone was kept. They're like, you haven't seen Pets, and I'm like, no, I don't watch these cartoons. They're like, dude, it's all about the dogs, and then let me see. And it's a cool movie for sure.
It wasn't my favorite, but it was cool.
I don't know what that is, but cats doing
cat.
That.
It was about cats.
Jungle Book is a perfect one. Bambi, I mean, look at this shit.
Have you seen Fievel Goes West?
Who? Yes.
Fievel Goes West. I knew you should
know
that one.
Fievel Goes West, you've never seen it.
No.
You have to watch it.
Yeah.
It's a mouse who travels to the West.
Oh, they go past. Anyway, what else do you have here?
She likes it because there's cowboy mouses.
Yeah.
Mouses. All right, that's it. Mice. Okay.
Yeah.
Mices.
But, I mean, this to me, people, is like such an important one. I really think it's one that we may not be aware of because, look, when you're in childhood and you're in your 0 to 7 imprint period, the brain's technically in a state of theta, which is like the sponge stage, like it's absorption stage, and you're tapping directly into subconscious. So it's like when you look at a kid and you like look at them and they're just asking why and studying you and they're looking and looking at all that, they're in just download mode,
right?
So similar, it's really like, that's what you should look like, since now we live in this tech age and everyone's like obsessed with tech. It's like your picture 0 to 7 is when the computer is like downloading the programs. Mm-hmm. Here you go. For the people, forget it, like they didn't even know computers. Your iPhone. You go to the app store and you're downloading the apps is like you in imprint period. Mm-hmm. Basically, that's it. So that's what I think is a huge one. This is a scene.
When was that last podcast? I think you said that really, really well. Wow. about like how a dog, you're downloading apps into it. I forgot how it went. Do you remember this one?
No, was one where I talk about what in multiple ways. So one, I say a lot of people don't understand what we do here with the dog. So they call in or they're, you know, they haven't really been following us and they're just like, oh, I heard someone recommended. They're like, oh, I'll check it out and all this. A lot of them think that it's like they're going to bring their dog here. Like it's a phone that has a virus. The tech guy is going to be, oh, I got to delete all this shit, this malware you have here. And there you go. Your phone working perfectly.
Right.
And then it's just, you just like smile and just go off into the sunset. Right.
You don't
everything's
have to
great.
Put it anywhere.
Yeah. So it's partially kind of what happens is we are removing a bunch of the malware and the viruses and the bullshit. But when you give it back to the person who is the person. When you give it back to the person who is going to be the one who's putting the viruses and the malware in there because going to sketchy sites and doing stupid stuff, then of course they're going to go back. So that's the dog going back to the human who's going to be doing the same bullshit habits, the same things, and putting the same viruses back in. Mm-hmm. So I'm explaining to them, look, this is one where I'm going to fix your phone. We got to get this phone cleaned up. There's a mess in here right now. We got to get it back to like factory reset,
right?
Which is the dog restoring to its former self, right? But we got to teach you how to use this phone,
right?
You so can't right be now you're
to certain sites. And
you're my father learning Facebook for the first time with the phone, right? You don't know what the fuck you're doing, but what we're going to do is we're going to teach you how to use this thing.
Yeah.
Oh wait, so when I press the F on there, that takes me to Facebook. Yes.
Well, that reminds me of showing your mom how to use Google Photos.
Yeah. Forget it. Like that's a whole nother thing. But I understand it too. We have to understand that, like they didn't grow up. There's certain things that these kids are going to be growing up with now that I'm like, what the hell are these kids using now? Like,
and they're
going
to look at you like, how do you not know this?
Yeah. Yeah. I know. It's weird. It's a weird part of life. Like when that starts happening, when you're like growing up and you're 38 now and like, well, this is the weirdest one for me that I don't know if I've ever said this, but the weirdest one for me is having clients who play for my favorite hockey team. Younger than me by a lot.
Yeah.
Because right now, if I'm 38 in the NHL, it's like, bro, how did you have that long of a career? There's like a few 20, people who have ever got. No, I mean, they go to like 35 usually.
No, but the ones that are in there now are like,
oh, especially
late 20s, early 30s.
Well, yeah, but even so, it's the Devils, our team, that they're young as hell right now.
Our team.
Yeah. Yeah. My team.
Speak for yourself.
Yeah. Okay. What team do you like?
I don't know. I don't really follow hockey. I guess it's just the Devils.
What is Cassie?
You go to games with us. You cheer for them.
Yeah. You're Devils fans, or else you're fired. It's a weird phase to be in with that. Like the team, like your idols and all that. And you're like, and then you're watching the game. You're like, yeah. And then you're like, wow, you're a decade younger than me, actually. But some of these guys are 21, 20 that are coming in now, you know?
Yeah.
Like Nico, who we named Nico Hischier. We named Nico after Nico Hischier on the Devils.
That's his middle name?
Uh-huh.
That's his middle name, Nico Hischier Del Savio?
Yeah, exactly. He's like 22 years old or 21 years old. It's like a kid.
That's crazy.
Young guy. We got to get him here. We need to get a video of Nico Hischier walking Nico.
Definitely.
Palmieri. One of you guys is the fucking hook that shit up.
Okay? Manifestation time.
Yeah, manifestation. Okay. All right. So what is this? This is a Lion King clip. Let's see what's going on here. I love these clips, by the way. There's so many lessons in these Lion King movies if you actually look for them and listen to them. Just the one lesson you shouldn't listen to is that a baboon is a human. That's the only thing you should be thinking about.
And you don't pick up on these as kids.
What? No.
A lot of these lessons. No, you're just looking at the character and watch them.
Creepy little monkey.
What do you think?
You stop following me?
Yeah.
Who are you?
The question is, who are you?
Huh. Stop that for a second.
I thought I knew.
That question there.
I thought I knew.
That question way there is such a fucking deep question that nobody wants to really dig deep and put a ton of effort into. Mm-hmm. Who am I? What am I?
Right.
They don't want to do it. I want to see what the external world will create and what it will give me. And then I'll become what the world has made me. As opposed to, who are you? Who the fuck are you? What's the purpose of your life? with the meaning of life.
Right.
There's a guy who I've been looking at a bunch of stuff on. Maybe I don't want to get in segue into something too crazy, but it's like a philosopher guy from back in the day. He passed away in the 80s, and it is, I mean, I'm so fascinated by that stuff. The philosophy things for me always are going to get me like, so like,
is the guy you were telling me.
Yeah. And he did one talking about like the meaning of life and how, you know, people will put so much effort into listening to their guru give them answers, but will they put the same effort into actually digging deep and finding out who they are themselves deep at the core? Deep at the core. Not I'm Jamie and I grew up in Jersey and not fuck that shit. I'm talking about who the fuck is in the, but when we dig deep into your soul, who are you? This guy fucking deep there for a second. Yeah. But that's the real shit though. That is like, for me, I was watching it and I was like, ah, this is so damn good. But who am I? Who am I?
It's a simple question, but it's so complex.
Yeah. It's like, you know, if someone said, well, what's your business? Who are you? Mm-hmm. Well, Pack Leader Dogs, that could be the label, or we're a company, we're on a mission, we're looking to change the way the world sees dogs and stop dogs from dying in shelters and being rehomed, and we're looking to use animals and dogs specifically to help humans find balance by practicing amazing qualities that have to be done to get a dog balanced. That's who we are as a business, right? We're not just the label. The label is just who it is, right? But that's, hopefully we can get through this without 10 seconds, but this is kind of how I go through things, but whatever. I think it's important though, because people skip through this shit and they're like, wow, that was cool. And I'm like, what'd you get out of it?
Yeah. Nothing.
Yeah. One thing that I love that guy does, and we'll share him next, is he goes, he'll ask the question like, who are we? And then he'll say, so are you waiting right now for the speaker himself? He said this, he calls himself a speaker. Are you waiting for the speaker to explain who you are?
That's good.
Or are you thinking, or not so much thinking, or are you putting in the work and the effort to dig deep and find out who you really are? Are you going through it right now? Who the fuck am I actually? You know, most people are, in my opinion, due to imprint period and traumas and all this stuff, terrified to look there.
Of course.
Because they're scared of what they're going to see. It might be something they didn't expect or have created in their mind of what they are.
This might get weird, but who
is ego?
Who are you?
Huh? I'm Steve Del Sabio from New York. No. That's a great question. And it's something I've been really exploring, and I don't have the actual answer to that right now.
Can you give us like a little peek?
Yeah, I'm looking at what my purpose is. Okay, so I see us all, this whole, we're all as one. We're all connected, mm-hmm. right? We're all connected to an energy source, God, universe, whatever the fuck you guys want to call it. You know, people can call it whatever they want. But we're all connected to one energy source, right? And to me, it's what can I provide that energy? What is my role in providing to the source and contributing and bringing more energy and positive energy to the source? Mm-hmm. So the whole thing, the whole team, which is all of us, which is including the plants, the trees, the animals, the everything,
right,
is how does that all fit together? And like, and how can we make that thing better and better and better? And right now, I think the world's in a somewhat of an adjustment phase. And it's going to be very, very interesting to see what happens with all this. Because I think that this could be a really bad thing or a really good thing. This whole reset and this corona shit and all that. It could either be one where we get worse with technology, go more dependent on governments, mm-hmm. where our individual freedoms are taken away, our sovereignty is taken away. And slowly but surely we become controlled. And then what kind of fucking life is that and what freedom is that? You don't have any liberty, mm-hmm. you know? And like, think about our country. It's life, liberty, and the pursuit. Is that what it is? Life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness, right?
Yes.
That's what it's all about. The pursuit of happiness and one's happiness. What is it? You know, and then now we can get into what is happiness. And I mean, it goes on and on. This is the philosophy, so, but this is why I'm so fascinated.
The question was, who are you, right?
Yeah.
And I think that you said you're figuring that out.
Yeah.
But like,
I have
who you want to be is a good question too, because then you could become that.
Who do you want to be? You are something. And then it's like, what are the characteristics that you want to be too? And is that, yeah, I mean, it's like who you are and who do you want to become? That's like kind of two things, right? So who am I now is knowing who the fuck you are right now, but with your past. Right. And if I said to you, have you guys explored your past? If I'm asking you, have you explored your past at a deep, deep, deep level? Have you asked your parents, your grandparents, your teachers from back in the day? spoken to hypnotherapists and like whatever it is. I don't care what it is, but are you putting in the work to explore who the fuck you are? Because if you don't know who you are, then what the hell are you going to do with your life?
Well, and if you don't know who you are, how can you adjust it to who you want to become?
Yeah. True. And the question is who you are the, and do you answer, who am I? Is it an ego answer? Mm-hmm. Of is somebody that's something that's been created through thought, which is, by the way, thought of somebody else, because thoughts are just nothing. They're just fucking bullshit. It's all in the air. It's just all made up. And how many of us revolve in our minds that we've created thoughts based on past experiences and situations and traumas that now are creating our present and our future. Mm-hmm. Hey, the dogs are playing, going nuts in the dog park right now. I see them out there.
And this is what prompted that question, because Simba's saying this.
Yeah, let's go.
I thought I knew.
He thought he knew who he was.
Now what a good moment. So sure.
Well, I know who you are. Shh, come here. It's a secret.
I know who you are too, Steve, by the way.
Yeah, thank you.
Enough already.
What is that supposed to mean anyway?
It means you are a baboon. Yeah. And I'm not.
There's an amazing moment there where he says, you're a little I thought I knew who I was, and now I'm not sure.
Right.
Yeah.
That's actually scary for most, but an enormous step in the right direction.
Oh my God.
Because I thought who I was. You know who I thought I was, what I was in my 20s? Was this fucking guy who's going to make all this money, who's going to be a fucking bachelor and have like the boats and the hoes. And no, but like all that, like just like hooking up with women and like, you know, like drinking and partying. And like that's going to be like Pleasureville, USA. By the way, I always say that one, Pleasureville, USA. But it's pleasure is not happiness. Mm-hmm. And you ask the people in pleasure, like who, you know who talked about that recently was Dan Bilzerian. Mm. So he's like he's kind of like the modern day Hefner.
I don't.
Dan Bilzerian he was a poker player that made a lot of money, and he's the guy that you see with all the models and everything.
He's like he's like your modern day like Hugh Hefner.
He has a beard. Okay. I'm sure you would recognize him.
If I saw a picture.
Yeah. So he's always with women. He's always doing crazy shit. He's adventures and this and all this bullshit, right?
Where were they going with that?
Oh yeah, he was the one who said so. People see him. He must be so happy. He's like, yeah, but people think pleasure is happiness, and it's not. Sometimes pleasure actually creates unhappiness.
Yeah, for sure.
Fuck, because you put so much stock into the pleasure. The
pleasure, yeah. Right.
You know, we were talking about this too, and this guy actually talked about the one I talked about. His name, the reason I'm not saying the name is I don't know exact. Like,
how to say it.
Yeah, it's like it's an Indian name that's like Hindi, like in Hindi, and I'm not sure exactly how, I think he's Indian, but I don't know exactly how to say it. It's like Jiddu Krishnamurti or Krishnamurti or something. I don't know, but we'll post it, and so you guys can talk about it. But he talks about that too, about the happiness and the pleasures and all that kind of stuff and how it's not the same thing in life. Let's go some more.
Is that accurate though, what I said?
What?
Of who you are?
Yeah, so someone who wants to, like someone who realizes like that I was, definitely someone who realizes I was being a suck from the energy source and I was taking like positive and putting back in negative, which made me negative.
That's and a made good me feel like to shit. Ask yourself too.
Yeah.
And how are you taking in positive?
Huh?
Like, how are you taking the positive in, like...
Because the message would be, like, how can I give back in a positive way, right? So if I'm giving back positive, then, and sending positive energy back in and creating more energy in myself. Because, look, when people are down and feeling like shit, their energy is, their vibration sucks. It's low. Mm-hmm. Shitty energy. That's the energy suck. Being anxious, nervous, tense, fearful, that drains energy. It's a huge energy suck. But you get rid of that and you live in the moment and observation. And you can stop your mind from fucking going and going and going and thinking and what's going to happen next. And we just exhaust our brain. We don't get a chance to take a fucking break. And then it's like when the break happens, you're standing in the elevator like, wow, I could give my brain a break. I could be standing in the elevator and just looking at the numbers, looking at the dog there. But what do we all do? Mm-hmm. That's what Jamie looks like that. But I just go like this. No, but you know what I'm saying?
So like, accurate.
We go to this thing. And then we say, wow, things are there. There's not enough things, thoughts, and I got to create more thoughts and more things. And oh my right. God, what's this person doing? And this person, and that. We got to get our mind, right. We got to give it a fix. It's speed right. Thing.
You were know? Saying, though, that you take in positivity before. You were taking in positivity and putting out negativity.
Maybe not even taking positive, maybe just taking energy and sending it back as negative.
I was trying to see what kind of
positive. I'm learning how to articulate all this shit, too, because I'm like the philosophy stuff I'm so fascinated with.
And if you're okay with that, I'm trying to have you.
Yeah, down, I love it know? Because like I'm going through this. This is to me the real way of learning and learning about yourself and learning about everything is is, yeah, hearing others and this and that, but putting it through yourself and seeing how it, like, how it, what it means to you and how you can convey that.
That's another thing that, of who you are too. You're somebody that really likes to learn too.
And then the other part, right? Too, who was I just, yeah. And who was I love learning.
Yeah.
What was I just saying about the learning thing? Fuck, I forgot. But there was like something that I saw recently about the learning. Anyway, whatever. I get confused by these things. My thoughts go so fast with this philosophy thing.
Do you ever take philosophy in school?
No.
No?
No.
I took one course.
I just love the way things are.
I took one course, and I can remember that the tests were, they could be answered so many different ways. So it was like a multiple choice test. And I think everyone pretty much failed the class that the curve was so high that like everyone got an A.
Well, yeah, exactly.
That's funny.
Because, but a lot of the tests, you're saying, well, it could go this way. It depends how you're looking at
it's
it.
It's the same thing, by the way, the dog. So what are you going to do with that dog to get him back to balance? Well, there's a lot of different ways to do this.
Right.
Yeah.
But I'm going to try to pick the one that is the least stressed to the dog, the least stressed to the human, and gets the highest result. Mm-hmm. That's what I want. And if there's one that gives me a higher result, but it's going to mean a little bit more stress on the human, fine, we got to do that.
Yeah.
You know, if they're prepared to do it. So this is like the big chess game that we have to play, puzzle that we have to put together for all that stuff. But yeah, who you are. I mean, God.
Yeah.
There was something else that guy said too that, that's what I was about to say, is people are all thinking about like when we die, right? Where do we go? What happens? This and that. And he talks about he actually had the quote that I put in the thing that said, if people learned how to go back in nature and connect with nature, there would be no need for churches, mosques, this, that, the other thing.
That because, is the church, isn't it?
Because, because the kingdom of heaven is within.
Yeah.
Fuck. You see that? And I was just like,
so deep.
I was like, I need to go to sleep now and rest and process what I just heard. Fuck, because it's so goddamn deep. It's like crazy how much that's how true that is. Everyone's like, where am I going to go? Think about how that is, though. Where do I? External. And we're saying everyone, the thing, the dogs, the Tony Robbins, Caesar, this guy. No. It's all with them. It's inside. What's the energy inside? Who are you? What's the thing there? How are we all connected?
So I said Steve cares about the world, humans, dogs, animals, and he also likes to learn. Do you have anything else you want to throw in there, Jamie?
About him?
Yeah.
Fun. I love to have humor too. I love because that's positive energy. Laughter is positive energy and good vibration.
It's good to see people's perspectives too on how
good you, vibration. Is that a song?
Yes, it is. The Beach Boys.
Yeah.
Do you have anything to add to
that? What else did you say?
I said that he cares about the world. He likes to learn. He said he was fun, which I agree with you there.
Yeah,
throw that one into the pot.
I think you're compassionate and caring.
I am
about people,
and that's a great point because I am. And then you guys,
great point.
Yeah, like well,
see, I'm trying to throw you some lobs and assists here.
Edit that shit out.
All right, cool.
no, but it's one that because I care. Is I'm willing to have those more cold, hard truth straight to the fucking point and tell you something that you may make you feel like, but I'm going to be there to when you're going down there to bring you back there. It's AS.
Steve's
it's okay
really
to hear
good
that.
At the tough love.
Yeah.
Really good.
I love that shit. Love. It's so important. That's something that when I was more insecure as a person, I wouldn't do that shit. I didn't want to deal with that stuff. And I didn't care enough about people to say, hey, I'm noticing this.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Look, even the thing, like, I'm not going to try to embarrass you.
Me?
But I will. Yeah, but it's not a big deal. Like, the other day when there was something in your tooth.
Oh, I was actually thinking said about that.
Right?
I was going to bring it up.
How That's many really people good will to... stand there and look at a person with something in their tooth and they don't want to say it to them because they're worried that they're going to have to deal with the person being embarrassed and are they going to feel like
So what was the situation?
It was one that Jamie was just showing me something, like, in one of the rooms. Like, hey, do you think we should put this here or whatever? And I was like, oh, you got something in your teeth. And she's like, oh, shit. And she took it out. And we talked about it. And I said, you know, it's funny, right? How most people – I said, first of all, in sales, that's a great way to build rapport for you business people out there is to say, hey, you got something on your shirt. Like, just I noticed that on there. Like, I had some shit on my shirt and someone didn't tell me the other day. And then people are like, yeah, that's true. I trust you.
Yeah,
thanks for
thank
helping
you
me
for
out. Yeah. A little compliment is always a good thing. I like those shoes. That's cool. Where'd you get those? Like little shit like that. That's rapport building. Where was I going with that?
How you were telling me that I had something in my
teeth. Yeah, I was just saying like how many people would go and not have that
conversation. She's checking her teeth now.
but how many people wouldn't say it and just let you go around the rest of your day?
I don't even know. Majority. It was there. I was talking to Cassie. Jay.
Yeah,
I don't know.
And nobody may have said anything.
I guarantee you they did, by the way.
Probably.
And they should all be fired for that shit. But
why do you think it is that people won't say it, though? Because I know what you're saying. And it is really good for somebody to be able to say.
Or sometimes maybe they feel like the other person may feel embarrassed or they might, you know.
Right. But it's more embarrassing for you to have it in there the whole time.
They either don't care or they don't want to deal with like that person going through feeling embarrassed or like this or how, like feeling weak. They don't want to deal with it. They're just like, I don't want to deal with that.
Right.
But I'm like, I care enough to say I wouldn't want to be walking around with shit in my teeth. So can you tell me that?
Absolutely.
Thank you.
I'm a big believer.
And if you do that with strangers, that's like people are like, wow, that's a fucking nice person.
Yeah.
When people are like how do
Cassie did tell me I had a tag on my shirt yesterday.
That was nice of her. That was very nice of her.
There was a line with that too. There was somebody who was talking about this and they said they went to something, some event. This was like not even a salesperson. And they were about to give their big speech. And someone came up and said, hey, your tag is sticking out of your
mouth. That was your client that said that.
What was it from?
She said that she just had an interview, or something like that, and then the person didn't even know her. They had just met for 10 minutes, like 10 minutes ago.
It was
they
a
met.
Big interview. She was all dressed up,
and the person
thing.
Said, she "Oh, she said, said it. She said it to the girl.
The girl was interviewing. She said, hey, your things are in the back." She said, "Since then, they've been like close.
Yeah,
since that time. It builds that trust and rapport.
Big time. Let's put some more of this on.
Okay, here we go.
We'll never get this done.
There's a good line.
That's okay. No rush here.
I'm not the one who's confused. Yes. You don't even know who you are.
And we don't own the rights
to
this.
None of you do.
Sure do.
We don't own the rights to this either, so YouTube, take it easy on us.
Yeah, take it easy. We're trying to learn this shit, okay? Yeah.
We're studying.
So harsh. Take it easy with your censoring, by the way, and that's a real one.
Oh, shit.
I'm not joking. Now you just got front of the fucking pack.
And now we're removed officially off of YouTube.
Exactly.
Mufasa's boy. Bye.
Hey, wait.
Hey Steve, you have a tag on me.
Thank you. There's me.
You knew my father?
Correction.
There's me.
I know your father.
Okay, so this part is like these kind of things is what I think about with Maddie. Like, oh, and she was, and is. Mm-hmm. Yeah. You knew Maddie? No, I still know her. She's still around. What do you mean?
Her energy is still here.
I hate to tell
you. He's calm, by the way. So he's to feel.
But he died.
There you go.
A long time ago.
Nope. Wrong again.
Yes.
He's alive. And I'll show him to you. You follow old Rafiki. He knows the way. Come on.
Did we miss the line that I was thinking about?
Probably not.
It's about change.
Rafiki, like.
Good one.
Steve's trying to go over it. No, Jamie, don't.
Hurry up!
Wait.
Let's go back at the end. But like Rafiki reminds me. Reminds me of Caesar a little bit.
Oh yeah.
Like the wisdom and everything. Like you'll say like you know.
Caesar has that Yoda quality to him. Or Yoda / like Rafiki, like very wise.
Aside that,
very
that
wise.
Not enough know about him. They know him as the expert dog guy and all that stuff. But like the amount of conversations I had with him about life. Like in the philosophy shit and all that. And like how deep he goes is like fucking. I'm so grateful for that shit to just have someone to bounce those ideas off of and talk with and hear their viewpoint on it. It's like it's almost like a thing like a guy like that is just more closely connected to the source or to like God or to the energy or to
well the animals got him there.
Yeah,
you know.
Yeah, that guy Jidu guy. He talks about how a tree is one of the most beautiful things on this planet.
Wow,
a tree.
Just what it represents and what it does, how it grows and all the branches off and the leaves off and how it provides oxygen to the world and all this kind of stuff. It's like so fascinating.
I agree. Here we go.
Uh-oh.
Oh, I just took down the sound. Oh, there it
goes. It looks like a dude.
All dingy.
In the back of the woods at night.
Oh my god, don't go back there.
Yeah.
Look down there.
So good. It's amazing. Like, it's so true, this shit. He's dead, he's gone, you know, what most people would think like, right? He's died. Let's cry forever.
He's miserable.
He'll never see him again.
He sees him in his own reflection.
But look.
That's not my father. It's just my reflection.
No. Look hard.
Yeah. Fucking look harder, everyone. Look harder within. So now look. Look harder within. What's that?
You see, he lives in you.
Father? Remember. Yeah. Fuck. So these things to me is a way to look at life. And to the people who you miss or pets or whatever, is we always think that they're gone, right? But energy can't be created or destroyed. So I always say, where'd that energy go? And then what he's saying is he's within you. But the energy can be within, like, so for me, like Maddie is, I got a huge chunk of her energy, but there's some within you and within mm-hmm. you who experienced her, right? So she's still there. It's still present. Right. Like you have to look and fucking feel it. So it's a great way to look at life. If that's a loved one who passed and things like that, we see it as a finality. It's over. It's done. Bye. So we do need to be depressed. Never again. Lost. Less than kind of shit. But what if it's still part of you?
Right.
It is part of you. Just so you know. That's what, I'm giving you guys the answers. This shit. This reminds me of like the Maddie stuff too.
Yeah.
Yeah. It's so good. Go ahead.
Simba, you have forgotten me.
No.
What a great voice.
For you guys who want to understand the definition of what calm, confident pack leader should be, study Mufasa and Lion King.
Big time.
That's calmness, that's respect, that's trust, that's love, that's caring about the whole, the pack, yes. the pride, the whole kingdom, all that shit matters. How it flows together, the circle of life. Oh my God, right. So fucking deep.
This Go really ahead. Is such a great movie.
Amazing. Go ahead.
But I... You have forgotten who you are, and so forgotten me. Look inside yourself, Simba.
Forget who you are, you forget
you
him.
You are more than what you have become. You must take your place in the circle of life.
How can I go back? I'm not who I used to be.
Remember who you are.
This really stuck with me.
You are my son, sing. And the one true king.
That's what I'm saying. These toxic people, that's what I feel.
Right.
And, 100%.
And their traumas and their issues and their stuff. Who are you?
Yeah.
Not the anxiety that you learn from grandma. Mm-hmm. Not the depression you learn from your dad. Not the fucking anger that was picked up through your aunt, whoever, or your teacher or the whatever. Who the fuck are you at the core? So that's something that I saw a while ago when I looked at like when I was in a like not the best mental state. I saw a video of myself in kindergarten and I'm like, look at him. I'm like, look at this fucking kid.
Yeah.
I was like, I feel like not like this kid at all. I feel like I don't even know who that is.
Yeah.
Happy as fuck, running around the class and what's up? Look at this and da 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 and all these things going on.
Or right, even life. When you look back at pictures of yourself as a kid, right? Don't you see just like a completely different person?
Yeah. And then what does society tell you? Grow up.
Mm-hmm.
You're so immature. All these things. Well, maybe you should go back to being like a kid and not take life so fucking seriously. How about that? Next.
I mean,
it's true though. I mean, I don't give a shit. That's the truth.
I think you were saying next, like,
well, keep this a little bit longer.
Okay, because I did want to go to the next thing. Because
no, please, don't leave me.
Look, so he's thinking he's leaving.
Father,
he's running away again.
No, bro, don't leave me.
Get this lesson again that I'm with you, in you. You have to know who the fuck you are and look within to find me.
Right.
And when can you feel energy
what
the most,
was
by the way,
that?
With an animal? When you're calm.
The weather. Very peculiar, don't you think?
Yeah. Looks like the winds are changing.
Change is good.
Yeah, it is.
Yeah, but it's not easy. I know what I have to do, but going back means I'll have to face my past. I've been running from it for so long.
Have you?
Ow! Jeez!
That's me.
What was
right
that for?
It doesn't matter. It's in the past.
Yeah.
Yeah, but it still hurts.
Oh, yes, the past can hurt.
Yep.
But the way I see it, you can either run from it or learn from it.
So
ah!
Nice.
You see? So what are you going to do?
Yeah, he swings and he ducks.
Yeah.
I'm going to take your stick.
No! Not a stick! Hey!
Confidence.
Where are you going?
I'm going back.
Good. Go on.
Get out of here. Go back there, bro.
Go face your past.
Look at the energy.
I love that line. Change is good.
Just deep wisdom shit right there. So good.
That was your line, Jamie?
That stuff gives me chills, those movies like that.
Yeah, definitely.
God, another great lesson.
You know, I was thinking while he was saying the remember who you are thing.
Yeah.
He's saying that to kids watching the the movie. Mm-hmm. Yeah. So it's like, seriously, when kids are watching that movie, they need to, they need to hear that line. And for me, hearing it as an adult, it still means the same thing. It's like, dude, remember who you were too when you were a kid, joyful, like,
Remember who you were watching this movie.
Absolutely.
Yeah. And then what we're trying to do with the dogs is get them to remember who they were when they were a puppy. Right. When they were born, who they really are. Restoring the dog to their former self.
So Steve,
which is not like they're restoring them to when they were like anxious. No, no, no. Restoring them to who they were at the core when they were born.
Mm-hmm. Steve, that's a video, 100%.
Yeah.
You're restoring the dog to their former state, and and somewhere in there, you're going to do some voiceover saying, remember.
Yeah.
It's going to be all like epic and like...
Steve's going to appear in the clouds.
Yes. Yeah, we can make that happen. I'm telling you.
It's going to be a good one.
And Maddie will show up there
somewhere. Caesar had a video he made like that when he was talking about dogs once, and it was like... I don't know who made the video, but it was like... A dog is just the da, 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 and it's like all these cool like B-roll shots and all this shit going on, and I was just like, God, it's such a good like.
Might have been Hideo.
Maybe I told him he should do way more of that kind of stuff because it's like he's like that Rafiki or Simba kind of, not Simba, Mufasa type thing. I'm like, you should do more of that shit, dude, because you're really good at it. And when he gets, you know, he gets a TCW, and all of a sudden like we're in like a Caesar wisdom philosophy mode where everyone's like just like you just see the whole environment, everything just
everybody's in agreement in that moment.
Yeah.
Like absorbing,
and we're just like, and then we're like, pause at the end of lunchtime, and it's like, holy lunchtime, shit, that was crazy. Do we have something else or not?
We're in an hour 10 here, and it is
okay. So we'll do this quick.
128. Do you want to see?
Yeah, I'm gonna have to pee at some point too. So we'll do this quick.
Check this out.
Yes.
Right now you have the next Simba or the next.
Yeah, let's do the next Lion King one.
Lion King.
Yeah. Lion King's fucking love Lion King. That opening scene is so damn good.
Why do you like that opening scene so much?
It's just like the animals, the music, the vibe of it, everything, how they're all together. It's mm-hmm. all one. They're all coexisting. They're working together. The land is green and like there's light and like all the good shit. And look at what happens, like the light and then the shithead Scar takes over with his such of the negative people. And the hyenas, who are all your downers, your haters, your let's go do drugs, let's go fucking right now. Those are those people, and that's what your life will look like if you do, kid.
Yeah,
that's true.
Because that's what mine was like.
Good, we don't want to hear about it.
Come on, Timon. Anything we can do?
Not unless you can change the past. Oh my God.
Hold on.
You know, we have to pause it.
So they told me we were gonna do this. They showed me this clip, right? And we were trying to say like, who are the characters? Who does what?
Who does the voice?
So I was like, I know this is Billy Crystal, right? Simba?
No, I don't think. No. Oh, Simba? No, he's actually another actor.
What? Yeah. Wait, who's Billy Crystal? Oh no, this guy.
Yeah, Timon.
That's Billy Crystal. Yeah, and we were like, who is this guy? So Adam pulls it up, and he shows it, and I'm like, he's like, yeah. So it's just Adam's like, yeah, it's just some no-name guy. So I go, wait a second now. I go, is that? And I name the person. Shit, this is the wrong phone.
Nathan Lane is actually the guy. Billy Crystal, I don't know.
Okay, but what's the guy from... Oh, I should have it right here. This is hilarious for you people. So I don't know if you guys remember Saved by the Bell. Mm-hmm. One of my favorites growing up.
Great show.
So good. And there was the time when they went to the Malibu Sands Beach Club.
For the summer.
And the crazy owner guy, Leon Carosi. Mm-hmm. Can you see it?
Further back. Yeah.
That's who does the voice of Pumbaa.
Yes.
What's his name? Ernie something? Where is it?
Yeah, I had no idea, but now Ernie
Sabella.
Like, oh, yeah, it's Mr. Carosi.
And wasn't the picture that you showed me like kind of small? I go, wait a second. I go, is that Mr. Carosi?
Yeah.
And they're like, nah, I don't think so. And I'm like, dude, it
is, you know why he
Mr.
Didn't...
Carosi.
You know why he didn't look as familiar? Because I don't think I watched that part of Saved by the Bell as much as the earlier episodes. Yeah.
Right,
well, which one came first? Was he on Saved by the Bell, or he did this first?
Who?
That guy.
He did a lot of stuff in the early.
I don't know when this came out.
I have to look and see.
Saved by the Bell. He was in it like
probably around the same time. I bet.
Probably.
Go ahead.
Okay.
This my buddy Timon here says you gotta put your behind in your pants.
No.
Okay.
I mean, amateur. Lie down before you hurt yourself.
This is what I said to Nico sometimes.
Yeah. This is what he
Nico,
said
to, lay down before you hurt yourself.
This is what he said to Jamie when she was saying it's going to be 60 degrees. No.
Yeah,
amateur.
No.
It's 59 degrees.
59 today. Don't give me that shit.
To put your past behind you. Look, kid. Bad things happen. And you can't do anything.
Put your past behind you once you deal with it. You got to deal with it. So hold on, bro. Let me explain, Timon, what the deal is.
He's about to explain. Can you hear?
No, okay, let's see. Yeah. Let's see if he says it.
Let's see if he says it.
About it, right?
Right.
Wrong. When the world turns its back on you, you turn your back on the world.
Okay, that's not good advice.
Then maybe you need a new lesson. Repeat after me. Hakuna Matata.
What?
Hakuna Matata.
I thought about this
It means no worries.
Hakuna Matata.
No worries.
What a wonderful phrase.
Pause it for a second before it starts. Remember what I was saying a while ago when I saw something? I said, you know what I realized, guys? Nothing's a big deal in life. Nothing's a big deal. In the grand scheme of things, first of all, we're not even a speck in this universe.
Yeah.
Go, like, put a telescope on, like, Jupiter and look towards the Earth and see how what you look like.
Nothing.
You know what I mean? So we're nothing in this thing, right? We're basically this little tiny thing.
Or we're everything.
Yeah. What do you mean by that?
We're everything. We're all interconnected, how you were saying before.
Yeah, there's multiple ways to say it.
I like how you said it, because you're saying we're nothing, mm-hmm. but we're also everything intermixed together. So when you see the telescope image looking down, you see the Earth. And technically that is all of us. Then it is all of it. Right. All the animals interconnected.
So I'm like, then if you live life like nothing's a big deal, it's a pretty damn good way to live. And I said, it popped in my head. I was like, it's like that Hakuna Matata shit. It means no worries. It's like, what? No worries. Like, hey, that person who's going to bring their dog, they canceled on us. No worries. What are we going to do to adjust? Mm-hmm. And imagine getting to a point where something really bad happens in your life, like a bad event, someone passes away or a tragedy or something like that. And you can figure out the way to not make it as big of a deal. You know what I'm saying? That like, let me stop my whole life and ruin everything and this, and it's such a big deal. And we were talking about that. I talked about this in the past, and someone I forget who it was. They were like, no, like certain things are big deals. And I was like, whoa. Well, hold on. Why is that a big deal? Like,
what's so big about a mother
situation? So it's like that kind of thing. So what's the big deal? Why is it such a big deal? Because this and that. I was like, well, that's also what I would call emotional reaction to the situation as well. Over emotional reaction. Well, emotional reaction, that's just too much of a overreaction for that scenario. Like you react in too high of a way. Mm-hmm. You know, make sense?
Kind of.
Okay.
Trying to follow you there.
Basically, I'm saying that stop taking life so fucking seriously that everything is such a big deal. Oh my God, my laundry's not done in time. The food, I don't have milk. Oh, what am I going to do? Like these kind of things. That it's not that big of a deal. Mm-hmm. Okay.
But again, it's all about perspective.
Exactly. Obviously. So what's your perspective on it? Like, we started later than we should have in the podcast, let's just say. Am I going to now have a shitty podcast and a meltdown and the end of the world? Or are we going to just say, so we started the podcast later. No big deal. What are we doing now?
Right.
Like, you know what I mean? Go ahead. No big deal.
Hakuna Matata. Ain't no passing craze. It means no worries.
Worries are thoughts.
For the rest of your
see you guys now. Other, based on other people in your past.
Hakuna Matata?
Yeah, it's our motto.
No, it's like, here, go get you some sprinkles.
Nothing. What's the motto with you?
Yeah, okay.
You know, kid, these two words.
What's the matter you?
All your problems.
That's right. Take Pumbaa, for example. Why, when he was a young warthog.
When I was a young warthog.
Very nice. Thanks. He found his aroma like a certain appeal. He could clear the savannah after every meal.
I'm a sensitive soul, though I seem thick-skinned.
Hey.
And it hurt that my friends never stood downwind. And oh, the shame!
He was a shame.
What a change in my name!
Oh, what's your name?
And I got downhearted.
Stuff,
not
though.
In front of the kids.
But look at this shit that's going on here. But again, getting back to the original point with the humans. Mm-hmm. Humanizing these animals. Like, they're all talking in the path. And I can assure you that if you go into Africa and go look and talk to some wild boy over there, or a warthog. It's a warthog, actually, I think.
Yes.
And you go to him and say, hey, what do you think about Hakuna Matata?
I don't think he's going to answer back.
Like, he gets bored by the thing in 2 seconds, you know? Oh, wait, look, there's Simba. Let's ask him what he thinks. Dad, your lunch for the pride.
Wait, so how's he going to do it?
Huh?
How's he going to do it?
But this is like, I love that shit. The means no worries thing. Like, because what is a worry? A thought.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
You know, what are you worried about? And it's usually something that...
And where do those thoughts come from?
It's basically a fear about a future event that hasn't happened.
Right.
Based on something that happened in your past, likely. So, fuck that. No thanks. You know? I really think about that stuff and about, like, why are you worried? What's the worst exam? Well, this could. And then that could. In the grand scheme of things, is that really the end of the world? Will you survive? All right. Not that big of a deal.
Right. Life will go on.
No worries. Why worry about it? Why don't we just deal with it? So, perfect example, when they told me, when Cassie said, yeah, Matt, it's cancer. Well, I could worry. And mm-hmm. I did go through some things because I was newly on this thing. But I did go through some stuff. But it was more of like just why worry about what's going to happen? Let's just, it is what it is. Mm-hmm.
Cassie and I were very surprised by your reaction.
Yeah.
We thought that you were going to...
How are you girls about that? I don't know if we've asked you this.
How we were?
Yeah.
We were a little emotional in the beginning.
Yeah.
Because we got a phone call like prior. Yeah. Or Cassie got it. But.
Yeah. So that was that. But yeah, then it's like...
And then how Steve handled it, did that help you guys? You girls?
Yeah, I think...
Yeah. I mean, we thought you were going
to
like...
Yeah. I think I went right to instruction mode.
Upset. You were just just like, okay, so what do we have to do?
Yeah, I'm like, and I said like from this point forward, I want anyone doing this like feeling sorry for the dog, like this and that. We're treating her as if she's normal. Everything's normal because everything is normal, by the way. And it's just something that's happening right now, but it's normal.
Yeah,
it's part of life. Why is it normal? Because it's happening. It's now. Because it is. I had this the other day with everybody, and everyone was just looking at me like, I don't think you guys were there for when I was saying there's nothing but now.
I don't think so.
Yeah, I was there.
There's nothing but now.
I think it was Sunday.
But what about tomorrow? Where is it? Can you show me that right now, please?
No, I can't.
You're going to show me your calendar? What is that? It's nothing.
It's not real.
What's yesterday? Where's that? Where do I see that? Mm-hmm. Oh, I have the foot. That's not now, though. So everything is now. There's nothing else. So why are we all searching for tomorrow? You have to go to the past because there's things that are creating your now to be fucked up. But once you get through that stuff, your now is just now.
Right. Well, you have to live for now. You can't live for the future.
And there's purposes of looking.
And the future's always changing too.
The future's always changing.
Based off your now.
Right.
It's looking to say, where do you want to go? You want to have a direction where you want to go. So that's a useful purpose of this theory of future and all that kind of thing.
Right. But things do change.
Yeah. And it's also one too where... That guy talked about also, he said one thing is to observe the beauty of something. The next, the problem begins to arise is when you feel like you have to have that beauty for yourself.
Mm. Oh yeah. You were saying this yesterday.
Yeah. So it could be like for instance, it's like, you're walking on the street and you see a nice, car,
mm-hmm.
right? And you're like, wow, it's a beautiful car. Like, I'm really observing the beauty of this. And beauty's in the eye of the beholder, of course. But I'm observing the beauty of this. And then that's, like, all good. And then if you continue on and go, and it's like, maybe one day I'll have... even if you get to the point where maybe one day I'll have a car like that, I think that's even, like, part of the problem arising. Whereas, like, if you go to that thing and say, like, I see that car. I need to have a car like that
because mm-hmm.
that's going to make me happy. And that's going to, now you just started your problems.
Yeah.
You know, you hear me say it, dude, when we're driving, like we'll be driving, like we got a Mercedes. Right. And I was like super pumped about it. Cause like, it was the first like nicer car that I was able to purchase for all the fucking years of like slaving away, getting this business going. But I said, like, we were talking about when we were in the car, I was like, you know, it's cool and everything. But it's not that big of a deal. It's like, so what? We're just experiencing a car and it's nice to be in and we're enjoying the beauty of it. But if this thing got repossessed tomorrow, it wouldn't be the end. I would be whatever.
We lost. Like it doesn't make you.
No, I don't give a shit about that thing.
Yeah.
And a lot of times too, it's like, it's the hype up to getting it.
Yeah.
You're like, oh, I want to get it. Okay, I finally got it. And it's like, okay, now what?
Yeah.
It's funny. But how has that feeling changed?
Yeah. One of our clients and good friends talks about it. He's like, you know, this is what happens when everybody gets a new car, like in a nice one. No eating in the car, no yes. drinking, vacuum. Oh my God, there's a little thing there. And there's that. Sure enough, like 3 weeks in, they're like, eh, fuck that shit. Like, mm-hmm. I'm going to have my sandwich in here today. Right. You know?
And that goes for so many things.
And then you're like, this whole car wash every week, maybe once a month now.
Yeah.
You know, like that's because it wears off. If that dopamine hit wears mm-hmm. quick. So people are putting all their stock into like items and things that you have to acquire. Oh my God, I have this now. So I'm so happy. And they do get that, but that pleasure dopamine hit. Yes. And then it's like, Okay, but that's wearing away. So now it's
now
on
I need
the
something
next
new.
One, and now you're chasing and chasing and chasing when you have everything yourself.
So, that's why within. As opposed to doing it for the dopamine, you just do it for the function of things, mm-hmm. you know, like just obtain tools that are going to make yeah. your life and job easier,
yeah.
but don't right. put so much stock in the pleasure aspect of things, you know, like, is it going to make me feel good?
It's also perception too.
It is perception. And something that I think about too, when you get into more materialistic things and buying things and having things, it's like, when you think about like, if you were to die, like all that stuff goes in the trash.
Yeah, no shit.
Like, thanks.
No, I'm saying that like no shit to your point. Like, yeah. yes, I agree with you 100%.
Like, it's just stuff.
Yeah.
And that literally, like, no one's going to, like, you'll maybe save a few things from like,
yeah, look what I acquired.
Family may, like, take a few things.
Okay, good. Pass it to other
you,
people
but it's,
now.
Like, it goes in the dumpster.
Yeah.
Like, but going back to the tools, like,
and how do you know yourself at death?
What?
And do you know yourself at death? Well, no, I don't know anything, but I have all this shit. Well, mm-hmm. that was kind of a wasteful life.
Right.
Going back to the tools things though, how happy are you when you get like a new like label maker or something, like, you know, like,
well, yeah, I mean, we all still have it, things that can make
it's also progress too.
No, but those
things
are
things that can make your life more efficient,
correct?
Can,
that's
you
what
know,
I'm
that, that's
at.
Different, but when yeah. you're buying just like, oh, I just want these like new sneakers because they look cool,
right?
Or,
yeah, that's
know.
Me.
Yeah, that's why I said it.
But it's okay. Certain things that happens, and you have that stuff, and yeah. I have those things.
We,
like,
I mean,
yeah.
we all do.
Do I need like the best of the brand new camera? No, but right. it's gonna make me feel good a little bit. So I'm gonna
that's
go for
thing.
That thing sometimes.
It's like it's okay to understand something that would facilitate something that would create progress mm-hmm. and create growth, right? But without having that one thing, not like then now on the flip side, you know, oh no, what can I do? And I don't have it. And what right. should I? How, instead of being like, okay, so they don't have that. What can I have? Or what do I need? Or like whatever.
And that's exactly right. what happened when I bought my camera. Yeah. I could have got a $5,000 camera, yeah. but I ended up going for a $2,000
right.
camera.
It's like, what do I really need?
And, correct.
And then,
you also honestly helped me with that
gratitude.
Part too. About which one to buy. And
yeah, and then gratitude.
Not splurge.
And then I'm grateful that I even have the ability to have something like this.
Right.
Absolutely.
And I know it could be gone in a second, so it's fine. If it
I'm
does.
Just grateful for our tools that we have here. Like, yeah. just I keep going to the camera thing, but the camera thing allows us to capture
yeah.
Something for the audience to see and yeah. gain value from it, which yeah. is why I value that thing. And yeah. it's just a tool that's going to make it easier.
Gratitude is the enormous one.
Definitely.
Yeah. So it's like, because look, and when you're saying perception, I said this one, like, I probably shouldn't name the countries and shit, but it's like, you know, you're in America and you start complaining.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. I don't care who you are. You want to go to Iran? Iraq? You want to go to live there and live in that environment?
Mm-hmm.
Because by the way, even people in that environment, You can always find someone who you think is doing better or whatever to complain about.
Right.
But at the same time, you can also find someone who's not doesn't have as much as you that you can be grateful for. So yeah. I would recommend doing that part.
Mm-hmm.
That's my recommendation for life, because most people they have in this and the envy and the jealousy
right.
and the, you know, ego, all this bullshit.
And take pride in what you have too, you know,
yeah.
whatever it is that you have. Yes, be grateful for it, but take pride in it too. Like, I recently got an apartment and I ended up like wanting to get a really, really nice apartment,
yeah.
but just the budgeting thing did not
yeah.
work out. So my apartment that I have now, I'm really grateful for it. And I'm like decking it out to make
yeah.
it, to making it to where I'm proud of it
yeah.
too.
Right.
So be proud of what you have.
Yeah,
and
take care of your
you
things.
You can make everything your own.
Absolutely.
Take pride
you
in
know?
Your work. Take pride
yes.
in your home.
Yeah.
Take pride in your belongings.
Yep.
Take pride in everything.
And,
like,
and
do
going
something
back
with
to
it.
My previous point too, I think awareness is another one. Because I know for me, I may get in certain phases where it's like, oh, I just start buying things. Or like, oh, I just want to get
yeah.
like new clothes because it's a new season and all that. And then I kind of like, I start buying things and I catch myself. And I'm like, wait, why am I doing
yeah.
this? Why
what am
I trying
to, what void am I fulfilling?
Exactly.
Yeah.
Is really
am I trying
taking,
to create this void in happiness of like my life?
Right,
somewhere?
Like what's missing
yeah.
in my life?
Yeah,
like
yeah.
where do I need to adjust?
Yeah, I well listen, talking about childhood thing, or you because you said the sneaker thing, this is one that I tease my mom about. But like I even younger was like loved sneakers.
Yeah, me too.
And my mom would be like, "Mom, I can't get this kid these expensive sneakers." So like she would like be like, "Yeah, we can get, but you can't get those. You have to get these." Mm. So then like the fact that even being told I can't get them, now I'm like, oh, new pair of Jordans can that bought like
yeah.
in 2 seconds. Like I'm like, I'll show you. So that's based on childhood feeling
right.
like I'll never be able to get it.
Right.
And now I can, you know? So maybe not the best example because I don't recommend parents like spoiling their kids with sneakers.
Well, yeah.
Right.
You know, but
even still,
but
you sometimes do that.
But at the same time, maybe it was a situation by her.
When you're told no, like as a kid, you do it.
Yeah.
Right.
Like her not doing that now created like the drive in me to be like, you need to like get to a place so you can do that on your own if you really want to.
Right.
So that worked out for me.
Or it makes you figure things out. Cause I know even now, like sometimes I'll say like, no, like we can't get that. I can't like,
yeah,
we, you know, really shouldn't afford that. And you're like,
timing.
Yeah. But Jamie, then you're, Jamie's your new mom. Fuck that. I'm going to find a way to make
that's
that
the other thing. That's the other thing.
Like, it's we like having that persistence.
You hear me saying that a lot too, is like sometimes I'm like, okay guys, you keep giving me the problems, but right, I want to figure out how the fuck we're going to do it. And then the problems to understand why it can't be done, it's like, I don't think we can do it because of this. Okay, but then next then.
Right.
Then how are we going to do it? So many people take like so much time and like, well, it's not going to work
because
of this, then this. They spend all their energy and why they can't. Oh, that's cool.
We've all been catching ourselves doing that.
Yeah.
Because like,
well, it's a human fight.
Jamie and I will joke around like, well, now with that attitude, it's not going to come.
Yeah.
But it's a good one to like remind ourselves like, no,
I want to know how. Happen. How many times you hear me saying it? I'm like, okay, like guys, this is the same thing. You give me four or five reasons of why it can't be done. And no one's giving me the fucking, is anyone spending time to figure out how it could be done?
Yeah.
You know, that's where we need to be. Because once you find out, it's not going to work because of that. Next. Right. Instead of like, oh, it's not going to work because of that. Damn. I don't know what. It's never going to work, and I don't know what we can do now. That comes down to the other theory I had about, like, people just don't want to put the work in.
Yeah.
Again, because it's like, it's easier. Well, it's look, hard. What's harder to do? Look at my page and see me correct the dog because he's doing a certain thing. Is it easier to go through my page, read my all the captions, go to the website, see what I'm doing, understand the concept fully, send me a message, ask me a question, put a comment, try to do a video call, whatever? Or just take the word of somebody else who said, that guy doesn't know what he's talking about. Mm-hmm. And you say, yeah, he doesn't know what he's talking about. And this is a big one that happens too. I think we talked about it. I'm not sure. But someone like that will then, they go to ideology first or the idea first. And then they search for data and facts and things that will fit into that. So not what's actually the correct way or the right way or what is the best way. They are finding my way, and that's the one that I want to find data for. And data that comes in that says, well, that might not be, because based on this data, they dismiss.
Right.
So they're actually extremely poor scientists at the core, because they're not
filtering
listening to
through
all data.
Only what they want.
The best data, the best scientists hear it all. They want to see
well,
every
even
possible
scientists,
option.
Even scientists will do that, though.
Yeah.
They will like a new piece of information will come up, and they're like, well, that disproves my previous thing. So no, I'm gonna ignore that.
Of course, but then listen, what people don't understand either is about and when people say science and all those things, we can get into a whole thing on this. Yeah. So I don't want to get all crazy on it, but studies are funded for purposes. There's agendas. Right. There's all this crazy shit that goes on that people don't know. And if you, this is my thought process, by the way. And this is like based on me doing this for 12 years, digging deep on human psychology, dog psychology, philosophy, the meaning of life, all this shit we're talking about. When you have somebody who says, that's all cool, but science has proven that. Those people, I'm just telling you for myself. Those people, I just go, anyway. So what do you have going on? Well, science says dogs like positive. Okay. Bye. You're showing me your lack of depth. You're showing me that your lack of context, that you're lazy about your understandings, right? All that kind of stuff. And they, you know, sometimes they find words and things to make themselves sign. But then you bring them into a park with a few dogs and they have no fucking idea what to do.
Right.
I've seen it over and over. I don't know if you were there. I don't know if you were there yet with Caesar. When we did one, like where I think I talked about it too, we brought in some trainers from around the LA area. It was for the trainers. It was like when Caesar was like teaching the volunteers and team like some stuff. Like it was not students and any of that stuff. And we brought in some other trainers to get their viewpoints and things like that. So there was like one person there who was like supposed to be like this big time trainer, and she got this following and all this stuff. And we said, okay, so all we were doing was at the kennels. Okay, so let's go in and get that dog on leash.
Mm-hmm.
So we're doing them, and isn't that? And right, Steve, you go. And I, you know, I mean, like, ding, back the dog, put it on, take it out, and put him in and sit there. We do our thing. Good. Next. Okay, you go get it. The lady goes up. No, 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 honey. Back up, back up, back up. Like this and that. She's trying to squeeze in. The dog's jumping all over, climbing all over her. Back. She's reaching for her food. The food's falling on the floor. And then all of a sudden, the dog gets out of the thing.
Oh,
and it was running around in the park. And it wasn't one to shame, but we were trying to like show her, look, like you can have all the knowledge you want and the theories and this and that. What you're doing is not working.
Right.
But you're too closed-minded and you're not aware of it. And until you're aware that this is looking like shit, there's no one can help you. So that's why I don't
open her mind a little bit.
She was like one of the ones, like it looked like her life flashed before her eyes. Like, wow. And that's the hard part for a lot of people. If you've invested 10, 20 years into a certain way, and then it's like, by the way, you could be doing it totally different. Those people, they don't want to like give up on the amount of time they did because they're so focused on their past.
Right.
If I did all this shit and someone came to me and I knew, and they were like, by the way, you could do this totally differently, do that, I would be open to it. I would want to know what it is because I want to know the right way, not my way, not Steve's way. But yeah, I was going somewhere with that, but it's one that you can see the surface level bullshit of, oh, that's what I was going to say. Gary V, my boy, said this great one about, I don't waste any time trying to convince people of anything. I talked to you.
Oh, yes.
Right?
Yeah.
He's basically saying, I'm not going to spend my time convincing you that posting content at volume with people that are, that with content that makes people engage, that people are liking, that's versatile, that has this and that, is going to be positive for you. I'm not wasting your time. If you don't think that, I don't care. Don't post.
Right.
And let your business fail. It's fine if you want to do that.
Your thing.
And that's the same for me when someone comes on and says, that's bullshit, da 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 da, and they just want to like say their way, then I go, you'll see it. Go on the Instagram. I go, that's great. Then if it's working for you, do that.
Right.
And they're like, wait a second, you're an asshole. You are not taking it my way. It's like, yeah, because I don't agree with your way.
Yeah, but
I heard you. I listened. You're not listening to me. You're not understanding. You're not trying to even get it. So I'm not going to waste my time trying to convince you. I can see that very clearly and assess and evaluate that. But yeah, so why waste my time? You know, they're set in their way and this is it. Then suffer. You hear me say it, right? Then you have to allow them to suffer. Mm-hmm. You got it all figured out, then fine. You don't want to hear it. You don't want to be aware. You don't want to take accountability for your life. You want to see anything that's possible. You hear, like, I watch the videos when we do the videos there. And everything that we do, I watch that video in detail. I'm watching myself. I'm watching the dog. I'm watching who's around. I'm watching all that stuff to get better.
Yeah.
There's certain times where, remember back in the day, I would say, like, I'd be like, and that's the reason you got it. And I'd be like, wow, I'm too intense for these people.
Yeah.
So I started learning and studying myself instead of being like, well, I do that because they need to know. And like with my fucking ego and all this bullshit, insecure and everything. Mm-hmm. Nah, bullshit. This is the best. This is the background the whole time.
Yeah.
But this is the other one.
Are you going to show this one?
I'm going to show a little clip. I'm going to try to keep you on schedule here. Yeah, just quick. Probably do another 10 minutes.
So hopefully that made sense to you guys. Let me know in the comments. We could talk about this shit forever. I have to get better about the YouTube comments. I know that. I went on there the other day and answered a few. I'm just, you know, in my scheduling mode and we're doing a zillion things here that I'm trying to get to all of them. And by the way, all those comments are me. They're 100% me. The comments, the captions, they're me.
So, I tell them what to say, but it's him typing.
They tell me what to say. They, they hold a gun to my head and say this or... Yeah.
But I type it out and he just hits send.
Yeah. And then I say it's for me.
but
that stuff's all me. So like I could do it in a way. Hey, Adam, answer some of those. Hey, Jamie, just put the smiley faces and whatever. No, that's fucking me. And I think there's value in it. Of course, I put on tremendous amount of work to myself to do that.
Yes.
But that's part of it. I think it's more important for me to answer those than just to get the things out, you know?
Yeah.
Nah, that's my theory.
No, it's really good.
Yeah. Go. Look at this. So then,
where's the sound?
Hey, Joe! Butcher, he says that he wants a two spaghetti special.
You got the schnauzer mix here, whatever he is. The cocker spaniel all talking on a date.
He's a talker to me.
Okay, he's a talker to you. You the boss.
The racist against Italians.
Now, here you are. The best spaghetti.
You know, but that's a true thing, by the way. Even that. Like Italian culture people can say, this is ridiculous. I can't believe how they're portraying Italians here. And da, da, da. Get over yourself. Then look, turn it off. Look at this. Woo!
This movie always makes me want pasta.
Really? Yeah, I mean, look at it. Is this not what?
Serenading the dogs.
Look at this. I mean, like, and then what's gonna happen? Then the kid watching this movie sees the cocker spaniel like that. Oh, look at lady. And she runs, and the kid runs up. Look at that. And row. Bite.
Lady looks like a biter for sure.
Yeah.
Uh-oh. We just want to show this scene, basically.
This is not me and Cassie. Man. Stuffing our faces with spaghetti.
The night will
nice. Look at the eyelashes and everything.
Seriously.
Yeah. The whole thing. But, yeah. You get to see it, right?
Yeah.
You get the point, people.
Yeah.
If that doesn't give the point, then I don't know what it is. So think about that. It's a really interesting one. How in and by the way, what do we call this kind of stuff? It's called programming.
Mm-hmm.
So as children, we're being programmed that these animals mean this thing.
Yes.
They're human.
Yeah.
So treat them as such.
Right.
And on top of that, there's many websites, there's many things and influencer pages that are the heartfelt and the look at the human and he behaves like such a human and they dress him up and there's music to it and all this shit, you know, is going on. But which listen, it is what it is, but there, and I'm all for like the heartfelt and the good stuff and everything. But we can't forget about what the real shit is.
Right.
Or what it's like to be with the dog. And how is that dog thinking? How is the dog feeling? And how are you? All these people I ask. You know, the girl who came with that dog that we were showing in the beginning. She's like, hey, I feel weird because it's like I'm the person that you constantly keep talking about. I've been through the ringer of trainers and I'm left in a worse position than I ever am.
Yeah.
I spent a lot of money. She's like, I wish I would have just went to you first, but I didn't find you until then.
Right.
So.
That happens a lot.
Yeah.
It's all good. It is what it is.
Yeah, it's all good.
You know, so.
So speaking of stereotypes, what? You were talking about the Italian stereotype. Golden retrievers are smart is a stereotype.
Yeah, it's true. Yeah, exactly. Look at this. But yeah, and that they're all friendly.
Yeah.
So we have a dog here for camp.
Oh, I'm so sorry.
We have a dog here for camp that's from the Ridgewood camp, who's a golden retriever, who is what people think all goldens are like. Super sweet little like golden who's mm-hmm. friendly as all hell, couldn't harm a fly type thing. And yes, but I've had golden retrievers with food aggression. I've had golden retrievers with human aggression. Yes. I've had golden retrievers with dog aggression. I've had all of them, anxiety, like the whole ringer. The worst one we always talk about, Caesar, Labrador, mm-hmm. Holly, bit the shit out of them.
Right, I think we were talking about that last week about like the doodles.
Yeah. So it's just that, again, surface level, basic thinking. Goldens are. No, they're not.
Which I feel like,
people are. That's like saying, like, again, I say the race is the people to a degree.
The music adds a little bit to this video. In Russia long
ago, he was big and strong. I'm convinced in this one that he's rubbing his face, too.
Yeah, sure.
He's enjoying it. And he's just pushing it around. He can easily get the ball.
Or he's just really smart.
No, that's fun. They entertain. So Nico does this shit. Not like this, exactly. But he'll put the... So did Maddie. Sure. So did Maddie. They used to put the ball near the edge and then it would go underneath. Remember Maddie with the couch with the ball?
She would do that all the time.
She would bring it by the thing and it would go under and then she'd go under and she'd be reaching like this.
Yeah.
Like to the thing. And then she'd look at you.
Yeah.
I'd go, where is it? And she... and all of a sudden the ball...
That's it. The other thing he does so well is like he mimics how like dogs like do. Yeah. So fun.
Yeah.
All right, guys, that was our podcast.
Yeah, I'm going to pee myself.
That was a good one.
We talked a lot. That was good. Really good one. Hope you guys liked that one, the
Disney
and dogs thing. And we're not even saying that Disney's doing anything wrong. It's just that we understand what it is, and it's culture. I mean, that's like Disney's part of like a...
There's also lessons there, too.
Well, there's a lot of life lessons in it. Yeah. Is Disney, you know,
well, that's what we're being programmed as children to watch that.
You're learning lessons, but it's also, are they trying to teach it through the animals to really show us that you need to learn.
The lessons are good.
The animals.
Right. The lessons are good, but the byproduct also is that they're not thinking about.
Right.
Is that like, wow, are these children going to see all animals now as human?
Byproduct or side effect. You can call it either one. There's something that comes with that.
Yeah.
Right.
And just be responsible about it, which is why I'm glad you're talking about it.
What you did there is like the
semantics.
The byproduct or semantic, semantics as well is like there's so much semantics in the dog training world where people are like, well, that would really be, it's like, fine, call it whatever the fuck you want. I just want you to understand what it is.
Right.
Yeah.
Call it whatever. Just understand what it is. So that's like the thing. Oh, so you do dominance? Well, listen, call it whatever you want. I'm just talking about leadership. Mm-hmm. I'm talking about, what do you mean by that? I just mean that I'm there to guide my dog in a calm, confident way to make them feel secure and safe and peace and loved. Trust, respected, you know, like that's what I want, fulfilling life, and to be there for them as someone who they can always rely on, their support system. Like, that's what I mean by it. They're okay.
Right.
Like it's when they actually hear it. Yeah. So like
different things.
Yeah. Just look, can I show, here, come with me, Nico, I'll show you what I mean by it. And you can tell me if you think this is bad.
Right.
You know, let me know. That's it. So awesome show today.
Good show.
Thank you guys.
Glad we got to talk about it. Thank you guys. Thank you, Ellie, for this drawing. It's amazing. Yep.
Thank you, Ellie.
We'll definitely frame that one and put it up. First Nico drawing, I think, right? That we ever got? We get millions of millions, but get tons of the Maddie.
Well, before this one, I did one online too, but it was just digital. I didn't.
And don't forget about sending me Maddie stuff too. I still love that stuff.
Yeah, we
I
love the Maddie stuff. You can't let
Anyway, there it is. The best. All right, we'll see you guys. Have an amazing rest of the week, and we'll see you next week for episode 25.
Nice.
There you go.
Stay calm and confident. We'll see you guys soon.
Thank you, guys.
Later. That was good. I love that.